four packages. There are 10, 11, and 12. There are questions. These questions are very good questions. You must do it because it's very good. A lot of material is with infection control, a lot of other things you have in those questions. And you will learn differently. Those questions are very good. These are all Lippincott 10, 11, and 12. And I will go ahead and start OB and OB and maternity nursing question. Now, you guys all have the package. First few things we all must know. As female reproductive system on the first page, and the menstrual cycle. We all know menstrual cycle is 28 days. And of ovaries and uterus, changes takes place when we are having the periods. And ovarian hormone you guys have is important. A little bit, sometimes they throw the question. So what is ovarian hormones? They are gonadotropin-releasing hormones are, underline the word, follicle-stimulating hormones and luteinizing hormones. So what are the hormones are? Follicle-stimulating and luteinizing hormones. And released by, remember, pituitary gland and hypothalamus. They control. Pituitary gland is a master gland, and it controls all the hormones. So what are the two hormones are there? Follicle-stimulating and luteinizing hormones. Next is you have female pelvis. In the female pelvis, you have true pelvis and false pelvis. So few things I wrote it down. You're missing in your package, and I added because I came across some question. And they say, what is the isthmus? So write down on the side and there, the uterus has three parts, the corpus, isthmus, and the cervix. And what is isthmus is the middle part of that. So in between the corpus and cervix is called isthmus. Are we clear? So there are three parts of the uterus. Upper part is the corpus. Second part is the isthmus. And the third part is the cervix. Everyone is okay. So we have three parts here, corpus, isthmus, and the cervix. So some question they ask, what is isthmus is? Is the part which is in the middle of corpus and cervix is called isthmus. So I added there, because there are a lot of questions I'm doing and they have asked that. But what is a true pelvis and the false pelvis is important. What is a true pelvis is below the pelvic brim. This is a pelvic brim. Below that part is a true pelvis. So the baby has to pass through the true pelvis. If the baby is above, is the false pelvis, until the mother is having labor, the baby has to go through the true pelvis. So what is a true pelvis is? Is below the pelvic brim. So highlight the word below the pelvic brim is called the true pelvis. What is the false pelvis is? Above the pelvic brim. Above the pelvic brim is called false pelvis. Now there are questions. What is a normal pelvis? There are different kinds of pelvis, but at least everyone should know. Is the best is gynecoid pelvis. You have in your notes. So I want you to underline which is a normal pelvis when the mother has to have a baby is called gynecoid pelvis. And what is in gynecoid pelvis is it's a female pelvis and it's the shape is transverse, round or blunt. Those three words is important. So gynecoid pelvis, transverse, rounded and blunt, the shape of the pelvis, is favorable for labor and birth. So what is a good pelvis is to have a baby? The word is called gynecoid pelvis. Everyone is okay? Gynecoid pelvis, we must know. The parts of the uterus, we must know. And what is the part of the uterus? We have corpus, isthmus, and we have the cervix. And gynecoid pelvis, we all know, transverse, round, and blunt pelvis. That's important, we all should know. I want you to add in your notes, sometimes the questions are, the spumps. What do you teach male to prevent the spumps? The spumps can be destroyed. You're producing the sperm in the male, so you add on the side, the sperm can be affected by heat, The men should avoid heat because they can destroy the sperm. Tight fitted clothes, the brief and the jeans. So avoid the tight clothes. And smoking affected the number of the sperms, and also strenuous exercise. So some questions are, how does the sperms are affected? Are by heat, number one. Number two, remember the tight clothing. So if you want to add it, so at least you will remember some of your questions. Smoking, strenuous exercise. You're doing a rough exercise, it can also affect it, the sperm, to be production of the sperm. So I want you to write down that also in there. It lowers the sperm counts. Now the next is, I want you to add in that section is prolactin. What is prolactin? P-R, prolactin, increases what? Secretion of milk. So I wanted you to write it down, the hormones, the prolactin affect us increasing the secretion of the milk. And oxytocin, you all know, oxytocin increase the contraction. Oxytocin increasing the contraction. So we must know prolactin helps in secretion of the milk, and oxytocin is increasing the hormones, is the contraction. And also progesterone, I will take this word out and I will write it, the progesterone, these are the hormones, progesterone affect the endometrium. Progesterone affecting endometrium. What is endometrium? The lining of the uterus. Are we clear? So what is endometrium is the lining of the uterus. And what does the progesterone does? Affecting the endometrium and also is repairing in the endometrium. So progesterone is hormone affecting where? Endometrium. So some of the part we should know when you come across some question are, so I wanted in ovarian hormone, follicle stimulating hormone, we know luteinizing hormone. I added prolactin, increased secretion of milk. Then I said oxytocin, increasing contraction. Progesterone is affecting where? In endometrium. What is endometrium? The layer, the lining of the uterus. What is endometrium? Lining of the uterus. Now, at least I added few things here, is these few wording are important. Now, underneath, I will move on after the female, little bit talking about reproduction. Now I'm moving on fertilization and implantation. We all should know, where does the fertilization takes place? You have in the fallopian tube. I want you to add the word upper part of the fallopian tube. So where is the fertilization takes place? Upper region of the fallopian tube. And occurs, when does fertilization takes place? Is within 12 hours, so I added here, and you guys have it, 12 hours of ovulation and 2 to 3 days insemination. So it takes place, fertilization, maybe within 12 hours, or if it stays there, maybe within 2 to 3 days. Everyone should know fertilization. Where does the fertilization takes place? In the fallopian tube, okay? And next is, how many chromosomes do we have? 23 chromosomes. So you have in your packet, underline the word, how many chromosomes we have? 23. And sperms carry, what does the sperms carry? XY chromosomes. And female egg, ovum, carries only X chromosomes. When do we have a boy? When X and Y, Y comes from the male sperms, and that would be the male child. XX is the female child. So everyone should know how many chromosomes do we have? Each cell have 23 chromosomes. XY, when you have XY is a male child, when you have XX is then you will have the female. And male carries XY chromosomes. Now, what is the word is called? So what is fertilization? So we have two eggs. The eggs are joining together and they start fertilization. That is fertilization word. Now, what happened after fertilization? They are making a baby, but what happened? The fertilization has to implant. And where does implantation and when does it take place? Underline the word, when they are implant, the fertilized ovum is called zygote. So under implantation, I wrote it here. What is zygote is? Fertilized ovum. So any question, what is zygote is? Fertilized ovum. And what is implantation? When do you do implantation would take place? When we have zygote and fertilized ovum, and implantation takes place 6 to 8 days after fertilization. Are we clear? So make sure you highlight the word. When does implantation takes place? Implantation will take place only when you have zygote. And what is a zygote is? A fertilized ovum. And when does implantation takes place? Is 6 to 8 days after fertilization. So what do we have first thing? Fertilization. Then what do we have after fertilization? Implantation. And implantation takes place after 6 to 8 days of fertilization. And where does the fertilization takes place? I want you right down there is I added here fertilization and here is 12 hours and here and I want you to write down the word is fundus. And implantation would take place where? After fertilization, and I circle here, and I added the word fundus. Fundus is the upper part of the uterus. Where is the fundus? The upper part of the uterus. So where is implantation should take place? In fundus. Are we clear? Where is fertilization takes place? In fallopian tube. So where is fertilization? Fallopian tube. Where is the implantation would takes place? In fundus. Are we clear? So those are two different words. Everyone should know is fertilization takes place in fallopian tube. Implantation would takes place after fertilization 6 to 8 days and where? In the fundus of the uterus. So part of the fundus of the uterus would take place. So if we are still on the first package and the first page, and I have talked about implantation word. Everyone should know what is fertilization, what is implantation. What is fundus? The upper part of the uterus. Everyone should know what is corpus and cervix is the part of the uterus. And inside the middle part of the uterus is called isthmus. And I talked about few hormones and make sure we all know because you never know what kind of questions you will see it. But it is good to know because we must know these are very important area. Now the next thing, so everyone knows the fertilization and implantation. Now I'm moving on, is pre-embryonic, the fetal development. When the baby comes, we don't say from first day is the fetus. We divide, is called, is fetal development. I have it here, you guys have in your package, and I have is. The first is called pre-embryonic period. What is pre-embryonic period? Is first 2 weeks after conception. After conception, first 2 weeks is called pre-embryonic stage. So we must know what is pre-embryonic. First 2 weeks is called pre-embryonic. Embryonic stage, underlined from 15 days or 2 weeks to 8 weeks. After 2 weeks until 8 weeks, we call embryonic stage. What is the third stage is called the fetal stage. What is the fetal stage is from 9 weeks until the baby is born. So before 9 weeks, we don't call the fetus. Are we clear? So what are the three stages of fetal development are? That's important, pre-embryonic. Second, you have embryonic. And third one, we have the fetal stage. And fetal stage is what period? From 9 weeks to end of the period. Now, next is amniotic fluid. It's important. We all know the baby is surrounded by the fluid, which is called amniotic fluid. And amniotic fluid normal is normal. How much should be 800 to 1200? What does it do for the baby? Cushion. It protects the baby. Highlight the word cushion. Protect the baby's temperature. And fetal consists of, what is in amniotic fluid? Baby's urine. So what does it show when the babies we are monitoring for the amniotic fluid? Underline the word fetal kidney function. So what are you checking? The amount of the fluid the babies have? It shows how the baby's fetus kidneys are working. So underline fetal kidney function. That means there it shows how the baby's kidneys are. So they're evaluating the baby's kidney, but what is amniotic fluid? It's baby's urine and is surrounding with the baby. And what does it do? Maintain the temperature, protect them, cushion them. And also placenta. Underneath, we must know a little bit about the placenta. What is placenta does? Exchange the nutrients and waste product between the fetus and the mother. That is the connection between the fetus and the mother is the placenta. When does it completed, implantation completed is 10 weeks gestation, and then hormones, underline the third line, it gives hormones to maintain pregnancy. Production of these hormones are 12 weeks of gestation. 12 weeks of gestation, they start giving hormones, and very important thing in the last line, the large particle, bacteria cannot pass through the placenta. But what can pass through is the virus. So that's why babies will get any viral infection. Mother has, the baby is going to get what? Is the viral infection. What else is passes to the baby is antibodies. Underline to what? Antibodies passes through the placenta and virus is passing through the placenta. So any viral infection can lead to problem with the babies but not the bacteria. Now the next page, if you all will move on page number 2, is we have on third trimester, we all should know when does the mother, I'm going to talk about the trimester and underneath, but when the baby is in third trimester, the fetus, then that is the time, underline the word, is maternal immunoglobulin. So they're saying, when does immune globulin passing to the baby is to the fetus, when does it pass to the fetus in third trimester. So that we all should know, maternal means the mother immunoglobulin passing and what kind of immunity the baby has. Underline the word passive immunity. What immunity the baby is getting? Passive immunity. So everyone should know in third trimester, what are we passing, what are we getting here? Immunity. And what is the immunity is we are saying is called immune globulin, maternal, and baby is getting passive immunity. Fetal circulation. There are fetal circulation we have, and what is in fetal circulation we have are the two arteries and a vein. And we all should know, because when you have placenta, and it might say, how do you check in the baby's placenta comes out, and what would you check on the cord, how many arteries and veins are there? Everyone should know, two arteries and one vein. And what artery does is underline the word deoxygenated blood. and vein carry oxygenated blood. So that's important that we should know. Everything what I have is here are in the question, and everyone should know the arteries and the veins. So when you have arteries and two arteries, arteries carry deoxygenated, vein carry oxygenated blood, and they provide oxygen and the nutrient to the baby. So from your cord, arteries and veins, they are getting circulation. What is a normal fetal heart rate? We all know 120 to 160. But earlier, 160 to 170, you have underlying in first trimester. There are three trimesters. In first trimester, the fetal heart rate can be 160, will be 160 to 170. But mostly questions are mother comes in, what would be normal fetal heart rate, 120 to 160. Now what happens if your fetal heart rate is less than 120 and more than 160? Immediately, your question, you read it, 120 to 160. Lower than 120 and higher than 160 is a sign of fetal distress. So read your question. Mother is admitted in the labor and fetal heart rate is 100. What do you monitor? Fetal distress. Baby's fetal heart rate 180. What are you monitoring? Fetal distress. Are we clear? So we must know what is a normal fetal heart rate, 120 to 160, normal. But earlier, in the first trimester, the fetal heart rate can be 160 to 170. There is a little variation. Now, there are three parts of circulation in the babies before they're born, and this is normal circulation. But once the babies are born, the babies comes out, then what happened? The lungs open. And what would be in the lungs? The circulation changes. And if the circulation does not change, the babies have what? Cardiac congenital problem. So what are the three normal babies had in circulation? We must recognize some wording here. Number one, ductus arteriosus. What is a ductus arteriosus is, underline the word, connection. They connect. And what are they connecting here? Pulmonary artery and two aorta and bypassing the lung. So in the fetus, there is no circulation in the lung. So what did we say? Pulmonary artery is connected with aorta. Now, do you remember, where is your pulmonary artery? Normally, where is pulmonary artery? When we talked about cardio, pulmonary artery is in the right ventricle. And what does pulmonary artery does for us? Takes the blood towards the lungs. But what happened here in the babies, this is not going towards the lungs. And aorta is in the left ventricle. Aorta is supplying the blood, but instead of going blood all over, it is connected with this pulmonary artery. So what do we have here is the pulmonary artery and aorta. They are connected together. For us, it closes. But what happened is normally it will be open, and the blood is flowing, going to the pulmonary artery. But here, what happens, they are connected. So where is the blood is not going? Not going towards the lungs. Are we clear? So what is pulmonary artery and aorta? They are bypassing the lungs. So remember, in the babies, there is no circulation in the lungs, in the fetus. And ductus arteriosus, connection between pulmonary artery and aorta, page number 2 on the package. And page number 2 in the package. Can we stop? There are a lot of people are waiting. So fetal circulation, we will go back a little bit on ductus arteriosus. What is ductus arteriosus? You got to know is pulmonary artery. And write down on the top, where is pulmonary artery? In the right ventricle. Where is aorta? Is in the left ventricle. And so what happened in the babies, the circulation bypassing is not going in the lungs. Are we clear? So they're rotating the blood between pulmonary artery and aorta. And number two, ductus venosus. What is ductus venosus are? Is connecting, underline the word, umbilical vein and inferior vena cava. Remember, we have superior vena cava and inferior vena cava in the adult. And what happens? The blood, deoxygenated blood, comes where? In the right atrium, from superior and inferior. But in the babies, in the fetal, what happened? The umbilical vein is connecting where? With inferior vena cava, and they are bypassing the liver. So everyone remember two things. There's no circulation in the fetus, in the lungs and the liver. But the adults, we have circulation through the lungs and the liver, but not in the babies. And the word is called ductus venosus. Number third one is foramen ovale. What is a foramen ovale? Is between, there is an opening between both atrium. We have right and left atrium. Remember, we have two atrium, we have two ventricle. But in the adult, both atrium are separated. But in the babies, there is an opening and the blood is going from right atrium to the left atrium. So the blood is only inside the heart. It's not going towards the lung. So what happened when the babies are born? After a few weeks, all this opening must close and circulation start as in adult. And that's why the babies are born and they are called cyanotic babies and they have congenital heart problem and they become blue babies. Why? Because they're not getting oxygenation. Everyone is okay? So what are the three parts in the baby's circulation, fetal circulation we have? Number one, ductus arteriosus. When they give any question, what is ductus arteriosus? They're bypassing the lung. And where is the blood is going from pulmonary artery and aorta. What is ductus venosus is? Is connection between umbilical vein and inferior vena cava. And what is foramen ovale? Is the opening between both atrium. That means right and left atrium and bypassing the lungs. So that blood is not going to the lungs, so it's floating between the heart, between pulmonary artery, aorta. There is no circulation in the lungs, there's no circulation in the liver. So that is the key wording here. Everyone should know in fetal circulation, those who came a little later, two arteries and a vein. It's important on this page. And when does the baby get from the mother's immunity? I said on the first line, third trimester. And what is this immunity is called? We must know passive immunity. So what immunity babies gets from the mother is called is the fetus passive immunity. Now I will go on is gestational and fertilization time of the ovum and the estimate date of pregnancy and how many days in the total pregnancy are 280 days and 40 weeks is the normal is the range for pregnancy. This the next three lines are important. I wrote it down here. The trimester, everyone should know is fetal development was on the last page we did it. Embryonic stage, fetal stage, and pre-embryonic stage. Very important we know. Because what is the trimesters are? We all know the word first trimester, second trimester, and third trimester. From how many weeks to how many weeks is first trimester? From first week to 13 weeks is your first trimester. What is a second trimesters are week 14 to through 26 weeks. And what is third trimester? 27 weeks to 40 weeks. So when you are teaching prenatal care and the questions can be the trimester word. And when they give trimester, you must know there are three trimester, first trimester, second and third trimester, and how many weeks. Nigel's rule, everyone should know how to estimate the date of pregnancy, is you take the last day of the period, and what do? Add 7 days and subtract 3 months and add the next year. That means is your estimate date, so everyone should know. Next one is also important to know the word GTPAL. They always throw that question, how do you calculate GTPAL? So what is G means, we all know gravida. What is the gravidity means is the number of pregnancy. How many pregnancies somebody had and including the present. They might say mother is pregnant 4 months. That means you got to include that one when the mother is pregnant. So we include that, the period of pregnancy and the number of pregnancy. Number of pregnancy and including the present one. What is the word term? Very important word is term. Include the children born, underline the word, more than 37 weeks. More than 37 weeks is called term. If in your question, any time mother lost the baby before 37, you're not counting, that is in term. Term only you count more than 37 weeks. Preterm, what is a preterm? Are before 37 weeks. What is preterm is before 37 weeks, is before term. So remember, term is more than 37, highlight that. Preterm, less than 37. Abortion is before 28 weeks, is considered abortion. Live birth is total number of birth and the living children. So live birth means living children. So everyone, GTPL is important, trimesters are important, and Nigel's rule is important. Now I will move on pregnancy sign and symptom. And we all should know the wording, the name, and what are we assessing here. So number one, we have presumptive sign. What is the meaning of presumptive sign are? Is presumptive means mother can feel. When we are saying probable sign are, probable means are the examiner can assess. So remember the wording mother can feel is called presumptive sign. So mother can feel are called presumptive sign. Probable sign, which is number two, are examiner can feel the mother is pregnant. And what is positive sign? You are sure there is a fetus and the mother is pregnant. Those are the three wording are important. Now in presumptive sign are, we all know mother can feel is breast changes, nausea, vomiting, urinary frequency mother is feeling, fatigue, underline the word quickening. We all should know what is quickening is. The quickening is first fetal movement. When the mother feels the first fetal movement is called quickening, and what is the normal time for quickening is 16 to 20 weeks. There was some question in multi-para, if you have more kids, maybe you can feel quickening earlier, and the answer was 14 to 18 weeks. So you can add underneath 14 to 18 weeks can be felt by multi-parity. Somebody who had already two kids or three is 14 to 18 weeks. But normally, when do you feel the first baby's movement? 16 to 20. That's important because in your question, mother can ask you, when can I feel my baby is moving? That's called the word quickening. Everyone is okay? So what is quickening is? Is the 16 to 20 weeks when the baby is moving. And in multipara, they can also feel around 14 to 18 weeks. So you can add 14, little earlier, because they had baby, they know their body, and they can feel early. What is a probable sign are felt by the examiner? What are the probable signs are? Number one is called Gödel sign. What is a Gödel signs are? Underline the word softening. changes takes place when mother is pregnant and is called softening and highlight the word cervix. The examiner can feel the cervix is soft when around second month of pregnancy. So when does she feel that? Around second month of pregnancy. Chadwick sign. When you do a lot of question, you will see a lot of time Chadwick sign. What is a Chadwick sign are? Is color changes, violet discoloration, or bluish color, changes of the cervix, underlying vagina, and when does they see the color changes? So the color is because the circulation, and around 4 weeks they can feel the Chadwick sign. So what is a Gödel sign is? Is a softening of the cervix. And when does they feel? Second month. When is the Chadwick sign? Is color discoloration. When? Around 4 weeks. Hager sign. What is a Hager sign? Softening of the uterus. So one is cervix, one is uterus. And when do they feel the uterus is soft? Around 6 weeks. So everyone should know Hager word is for the uterus and Gödel sign is for cervix. And when they give you the word Chadwick sign, that's a discoloration, changes takes place, and when the examiner feel and they're checking the mother, they can feel these changes. Now, positive pregnancy test comes under probable sign. Why? Because the first doctor is the one will order, or even you do pregnancy tests is showing would go in more probable sign. Are we clear? Positive blood test, doctor has ordered, and urine test, doctor has ordered, goes in the probable sign. Next is Braxton Hicks contraction. What is Braxton Hicks contraction? Are underline the word irregular contraction. Another word, remember, like a false contraction, they're irregular, and they're coming throughout, highlight that word, from starting and throughout the pregnancy. But what does not it do? It does not cause any is cervical dilation. Do not increase in intensity and duration. It doesn't increase intensity. It doesn't cause very strong is contraction. And remember the word, it does not help in dilation. So what is Braxton Hicks contraction? Irregular contraction. And second word is very important in the second line, does not cause dilation. Are we clear? So what is Braxton? So wording is important. They throw the wording. Quickening means the first fetal movement. What is Braxton Hicks contraction? Irregular contraction. Then you will move on, blotchment. What is a blotchment? Is rebounding of the fetus against the examiner when they're feeling and they're doing palpation and baby is moving against the examiner finger is called the blotchment. So what is a blotchment? Is rebounding of the fetus. Fetus is moving, rebounding on the examiner finger on palpation. Everyone should know these wording, and you guys have here, just remember, review them and know the wording, because they throw the wording quickening, they will throw the word Hager sign, so you don't confuse yourself and you know exactly the wording. Now the last is, the third is positive sign. How do we know positive sign are? By visualizing of the fetus. Next page, on visualizing the fetus by ultrasound. So when you do ultrasound, that's positive. And ultrasound examination, when can be done? In 6 weeks. Are you guys are okay? The pages? In the back?
They're stapled wrong, but yeah.
They're stapled wrong, so go in the back and see where it says positive signs. Okay, everyone, just look in the back. Just tell them where it is in the back.
The last page.
The last pages. So they're stapled in the wrong way in the last pages. Okay. Everyone, okay? All right. So positive signs are is what are the positive signs? Ultrasound. When is ultrasound can be done? 6 weeks. Underline that. And also, is electronical devices, when they can hear the baby, electronical devices. And I want you to underline that, is cross out the word 20 weeks is wrong. So when you have electronical devices, when do you hear the baby's sounds or the fetal heart rate? 8 to 12 weeks. So cross out 20 and write down there 8 to 12 weeks. And also electronical devices, they use the word Doppler. I want you to write down the word Doppler. So if they say, when do you hear by Doppler? 8 to 12 weeks. If they're saying electronically, when do you hear the fetal heart rate? Would be 8 to 12 weeks. When do you hear in fetoscope? Fetoscope, you hear 20 weeks. And underneath, you can write down 18 to 20 weeks. Some of the variation they give, around 18 weeks, you will go for electronical devices. I said 8 to 12 weeks you can go, and 18 to 20 weeks you will go fetoscope. So let me go back here. Let's make sure we correct it. Ultrasound is 6 weeks. Electronical devices, Doppler, 8 to 12 weeks, you hear the fetal heart rate, and fetoscope, everyone should know. Many books you will do question, these questions are there. And so they will ask you, when do we hear the fetal heart rate on electronical devices? 8 to 12 weeks. When do you hear in fetoscope? 18 to 20 weeks. So both we should know, and that would be correct. Now the next thing is fundal height. Now remember, what is fundus? I said the upper part of the uterus is fundus. Now how do you measure fundal height of the mother? So what do? We check the stomach here on the abdomen, and where you feel how far the uterus is growing out of the pelvic area, that is your fundal height. So I want you to, and everyone should know, fundal height is important to know, and underline the word, what position? Now a lot of questions are, is they're asking the positioning. And we are nurses, we got to help the doctor, or we are checking ourselves, the mother lays on what position? Supine position. What do you need to measure? You need a tape, because you're going to measure the fundal height. So tape measurement. And what would you check from where to where? Underline the word, is from symphysis pubis. So where do you take the tape? From symphysis pubis, and how far you will take that tape is underline the word uterine fundus. So what do? Let the mother lay on the table, and you are feeling where is the fundus in the stomach, and you can feel the fundus is right here, and you take a tape, and you're putting a tape from where? Our pubic bone right here. From symphysis pubis to fundal height, to the fundus. So wherever you are feeling the uterus, you take a tape from where? From the symphysis pubis to where? To the fundus area. Are we clear? So what is a fundal height is? You are measuring how far the fundus is, how far the mother is pregnant. How do you check the fundal height? Mother would be laying in supine position. And where do you measure the fundal height from? Your answer, symphysis pubis to where you feel the fundus. So you are palpating, and you can feel here the fundus is coming out. So you are measuring the tape, and you will see how far the mother is pregnant. Now also, fundal height, where it says in your notes, it says there, fundal height is also evaluating. In fundal height, you are evaluating gestational age. What is the meaning, gestational? How big the baby is, how far, how many weeks the baby is. Are we clear? So fundal height, what are you measuring also? Gestational age. So if they give you, if they didn't give you a question, how do you measure fundal height? But they're saying, how do you measure gestational age? Is same as fundal height. Lay the mother on supine position, you take a tape and you measure. Now second line under fundal height, make sure we highlight the word during second and third trimester. When mother is around second trimester and third trimester, fundal height, when you're measuring for fetal age, you will go in feet. So if it comes fundal height in centimeter, you're going to use the word here, feet. So if you have 18 centimeter, you will say 18 weeks is the baby is. Are we clear? So what is the fundal height you're measuring? You're also measuring gestational age. How far is the gestational? If you're saying gestational age, that means how far is the baby? And then you will use the word weeks. Are we clear? So what is your the measuring tape? If it's in inches, centimeter, you put the word is weeks for gestational height. So everyone underline those wording. What is fundal height is? You are measuring how far the fundus is. What do? Lay the mother on supine position. You take a tape, and your tape will be on the symphysis pubis. Wherever you feel the fundus, you stretch the tape and measure in centimeters. But when you're doing gestational age, that means the baby's age, you will use the word weeks. Only you will count that from second trimester to third trimester. So when they use the word, everyone make sure we know the word, is a fundal height and gestational age is same way you're measuring, but you're using the word is weeks here. Now, if they give you a question, mother is pregnant 14 to 16 weeks in the fourth line, where would be normally fundal height is? Your answer, without even measuring, they're saying, what would be normally do you think the fundal height would be? Then your answer is above the symphysis pubis. So this is your bone here, symphysis pubis. You can feel, but it hasn't gone too far. So just above where is the symphysis pubis? Everyone is okay? So where is 14 to 16 weeks? That means the uterus is leaving the pelvic area and moving towards the abdomen. Are we clear? So where do you feel the fundal height here? Just above the symphysis pubis. But remember, when mother is going full term, fundus would be going up and she's fully blown pregnant person. So fundal height, 14 to 16 week, everyone should know, very important, where is the fundal height? Your answer would be above the symphysis pubis. If they give you a question and they're asking you, where is the fundal height around 20 weeks or 22 weeks, now where? Umbilicus area. So where is about 20 weeks, though you can feel the fundus, that means you can feel the uterus right here. So where would be the fundal heights? Remember, what is fundus? Fundus is upper part of the uterus and is growing up, and you can feel and you are checking how far the mother is pregnant. So when you have at the umbilical area, how far the mother is 20 to 22 weeks. Now when mother goes full term, now where would be around xiphoid process? Are we clear? So full term, mother, the baby is growing, and you can see the mother is, where is she's full term pregnant, about xiphoid process. And before just delivery time, what happened? The babies start moving down. And that would be before, just before your delivery time comes, then the babies are moving down because it has to fix in the pelvic area. Are we clear? So everyone is okay, fundal height? What position do we have on fundal height? Is supine position. Where do you measure? From symphysis pubis to the fundus area. Fundus is upper part of the uterus. 14 to 16 weeks above symphysis pubis. 20 to 22 weeks is umbilical area. At the full term, where would be the fundal height? Is about xiphoid process. Everyone is okay. You got to know those wordings. Now I will move on a little bit on maternal risk during the pregnancy. Or what are the maternal risk are during pregnancy? The word is called TORCH. It's a group of causing problem which can cross the placenta and affecting the fetus. That means those infection can affect the fetus. T means is toxoplasmosis. So what is T means is infection is toxoplasmosis. O means other infection. That means hepatitis A and B and streptococcal infection. So mother has streptococcal hepatitis can pass to the baby. Number R is rubella. C means cytomegalus virus. Cytomegalus virus can cause infection. And H means is herpes. So H means is what is herpes can be sexually transmitted infection. So we all need to know the word TORCH. Toxoplasmosis, other means hepatitis A and streptococcal infection, rubella, cytomegalus virus, and H herpes can be transmitted to the fetus. Substance abuse. Mother is taking any substance abuse. What does it affect to the baby? Risk for, underline the word, you have a couple of them, but I will have highlight the main word, miscarriage. Mothers start taking any substance abuse. She can lose the baby. Stillborn baby, premature baby, and sudden infant death syndrome. Baby can die. So all of a sudden, we are using substance abuse can lead to what? What are the problem can be? Miscarriage, prematurity, babies can be low birth weight and sudden infant death. Alcohol. Babies are called fetal alcohol syndrome and congenital abnormalities. Underline the word jitteriness. They can be very jittery and physical abnormalities. Add their feeding problem. They will have vomiting and irritability. Babies are born with alcohol, fetal alcohol syndrome. Minimum stimulation. Don't stimulate them. Quiet environment. So alcohol syndrome babies are monitored for feeding and vomiting. They can have irritability. You can add that. And you already have the congenital jitteriness, two of them. Smoking can lead to low birth weight babies. So if mother is smoking, the baby is going to be low birth weight baby. And a stillbirth can also cause defect in the babies. So some of the questions are for alcohol abuse mother and when they're doing smoking, what can it cause the fetus? Now some question can be on adolescent pregnancy, early age pregnancy. And what would be you monitor in adolescent early age pregnancy are, underline the word, nutrition. What would you teach the mother who is adolescents, early adolescent, teenager? Questions are, what do you teach them? Because they are not eating a healthy diet. So what do you teach them is nutritional. They have poor nutrition. Second line, support system. Some of them may not be having any family support. And underline the word stillborn. Babies are risk for a stillbirth, low birth babies are. And third line underneath, hypertension, preeclampsia, very common in teenager pregnancy. And also cephalopelvic disproportion. Two answers you will always see, nutrition, cephalopelvic disproportion. What do you monitor early age pregnancy person are? For preeclampsia, hypertension. See, your questions are not only memorizing, but make sure you connect. Your questions are going to be, you're admitting a person is a teenager. What would you monitor for that mother here? Is cephalopelvic disproportion. Why? Because their pelvic size is not grown yet. And when the baby's head is coming down, it can cause a problem because of the pelvic size. So early age pregnancy, teenager pregnancy, adolescent questions are, number one, nutrition. Number two, cephalopelvic, low birth babies. And we have a lot of stillbirth babies with the teenager pregnancy. And also, last line is socioeconomic environment. That means support system. They will need some help, and you will go on, your questions are. Now, if they give you, mother is teenager, how many calories mother should be taking? I want you to add there about 2,500 calories. They need more calories and teenager person. And if they give you, mother is a teenager, how many calories she should get? Good calories, not 1,200, not 1,600, is 2,500 calories. She needs more, is developing their growth. So adolescent question, here is, we talked about some infection, and here. So everyone, nutrition, cephalopelvic disproportion, and teenager calories, how many calories you give. Now next is, I have in my pages, so make sure you have opiate analgesic. That means I'm talking a little bit about the medications here. What are the drugs are common we are using here is, number one, we all should know Narcan. Narcan we all know. But what is another word for Narcan is naloxone. So make sure we know. Sometimes they just throw naloxone. Naloxone is Narcan, is antidote for your opiates, morphine. And you're giving as antidote. Demerol you're giving for pain. And underlying for Demerol is called Meperdine. Another word is for Demerol is Meperdine. And what do you monitor when you are giving Demerol? Underline the word low blood pressure. And second line is respiratory depression. So you're giving Demerol. What do you monitor is the blood pressure. What do you monitor the mother here for respiratory depression? Phenergan is given for nausea. When mother feels nausea and vomiting, they can use the Phenergan. Morphine sulfate is also given for pain. When they are giving morphine, it can cause fetal distress and underline the word hypotension. So what do you give them? Hypotension, monitor for hypotension. So it not to be given early labor. Mother comes in labor, early labor, don't give them. Why? Because it's going to slow the labor process. Mother with the slowing down the labor. So remember, Demerol is for pain, morphine is for pain, and what do you monitor here? The blood pressure. Morphine sulfate can also cause fetal distress. And also do not give them in early labor. Statidone is also for pain, underline that, and is not to be given. You can give for pain, but don't give statidone when mother is in second stage of labor. That means the baby is coming out. Don't give those medication. Nubain is also for pain. Statidone and Nubain are better than Demerol and morphine. And what does it cause? Nubain is less respiratory distress. It causes less respiratory distress. So make sure we highlight few words that you all know. Antidote, naloxone, we all know, is Demerol, morphine for pain, Phenergan for nausea and vomiting, Statidone is for pain, Nubain is for pain. Nubain and Statidone affect less and it cause less respiratory problem. Rogam, we all should know Rogam. You can give them twice, 28 weeks and 72 hours after the birth. And who do you give them? For negative mother and positive baby. I want you to add there, if positive, direct comb test, it's a blood test. Combs test is positive, you do not give Rogam. So any question, mother has positive comb test, you do not give Rogam because mother has already been sensitized. And Rh incompatibility, and you're giving to the mother Rogam if mother is negative and the baby is the positive. If mother blood test or direct comb test is positive, you do not give Rogam. Are we clear? So add that in there because there are in some question. What do you monitor for the mother when you give them? Is temperature and tenderness at that injection site. Is painful and tenderness you monitor for the adverse reaction. Rubella vaccine. How do we give rubella vaccine? Underline sub-Q. Second line, when sub-Q, subcutaneously, and when do you give? When rubella titer the blood, less than 1.8. Some question they can ask. And given, do not give if family member are immune compromised. Teach contraceptive when you're giving. And you're giving rubella vaccine is for German measles, and mother should not get pregnant for 3 months. Avoid pregnancy after immunization. Adverse reaction are hypersensitivity, means the rashes. So rubella vaccine is for German measles. And negative, if you are giving the mother, she have rubella titer less than 1.8, and give them. And 3 months, no pregnancy. Hepatitis B, you're giving to the child. And IM before discharge. So hepatitis B, you give before baby is going home, the first dose. Or you can write down on the top, 0 to 2 months, the first dose should be given. 0 to 2 months, mostly babies before they're discharging, they give them hepatitis B vaccine. And where do you give them? Vastus lateral, you can highlight that. And also monitor for rash, erythema, and pain. Now, when do you give second dose? After is 6 months, you can give in after a month another dose, and before 6 months, you finish 3 doses. So how many total dose of hepatitis B? 3 doses. First, you are giving 0 to 2 months. After another month, you can give second dose, but before 6 months, you can finish 3 doses of hepatitis B. So age 1 month you can give, then 6 months you can give and finish that. Eye medication in the newborn babies are, you put them in their eyes are erythromycin, eitosin, and tetracycline. Those 3 drugs they can put it in. Erythromycin, a lot of questions they ask, and why do you give them? Second line, to prevent gonorrhea, sexually transmitted disease. And silver nitrate, they can also use it, but silver nitrate can cause conjunctivitis, and they can give them for chlamydial infection. But mostly is for gonorrhea. And what does it can lead to if you don't give them is blindness. Gonorrhea can lead to what? Blindness. I want you to write down the word ophthalmia neonatrum word. And if they give you what is ophthalmia neonatrum, blindness, which is from the gonorrhea. So why do you give these eye drops are to prevent ophthalmia neonatrum. Ophthalmia means eye. So they use the word ophthalmia. Ophthalmia and neonatrum. Neonatrum, ophthalmia, eyes, neonatrum, newborn babies. And what does it cause? Blindness. And you're preventing blindness, but the word is called ophthalmia neonatrum. So why do we put eye drops in the baby's eye? To prevent ophthalmia neonatrum. And that is the blindness in the babies. And that is one of the reasons that you are preventing their blindness. Next is medication, prostaglandin. In prostaglandin, you have prostaglandin E1, and also another name is called Cytotec, and prostaglandin E2. And what is the prostaglandin is? For contraction, but the word is, underlying the word, ripen the cervix. It's stretching the cervix and causing dilation and effacement. What is the meaning of effacement? When the baby is moving, contractions are getting stronger. Effacement means thinning of the uterus. That means it's stretching because the baby is moving. So what is your prostaglandin is given? Maybe answer ripen the cervix. Maybe your answer increasing contraction and helping underline at the end, dilating and effacement. and causing uterine contraction. So dilation, when dilation takes place, the uterus is getting thin, and that's the word is effacement. Effacement is dilation and thinning of the uterus. And given, it is given during the labor, and adverse effect is nausea, vomiting. Underline the word hypotension. Underline the word is fetal passage of meconium. What is the meaning, fetal passage? Any question? Baby is passing meconium. What do you monitor the mother and the baby? Write down the word fetal distress. Because the contractions are coming so quick. So what can happen? The baby can go in fetal distress. So passing meconium is sign of fetal distress. So what do you monitor when you're giving prostaglandin is prostaglandin E1, E2. I'm repeating the word, or ripen the cervix, dilating, effacement word, increasing contraction. What do you monitor when you're giving prostaglandin? Monitor the mother for hypotension and fetal distress if the baby passed the meconium. Okay? So next is magnesium sulfate. Magnesium sulfate is anticonvulsion. And where does it depress? Central nervous system. So magnesium sulfate is given for what? Write down on the top, for preeclampsia mother. And what are you preventing in preeclampsia mother? Here is the convulsion. So what is magnesium sulfate? Is convulsion medication. And what is the antidote for magnesium sulfate? Is here calcium gluconate. So what is antidote here? Calcium gluconate. And what does it prevent here? Anticonvulsion. That means you're preventing from convulsion. Next page we have, on page number 5, you guys may have probably backwards, so look on that. And says on the top, to prevent seizure, magnesium sulfate is given to prevent seizure. Adverse effect are, I want you to be monitoring for adverse effect in the second line. What are the adverse effect are? Respiratory, hypotension, and decreasing urine output. In the fourth line is, you can also give post 24 hours postpartum if used for preeclampsia. If mother has been using this, and after 24 hours can also be given to prevent seizure. Continuously can cause toxicity. Contraindicated, you cannot give if mother has cardiac problem and the renal problem. So you have renal failure. Everyone should know the normal level of magnesium. Remember, labs are very important. Whatever, whether it comes in peds and OB, labs are important. So what is a normal magnesium sulfate level is? Underline target, 5 to 8. Normal 7.5 is okay, but they want to keep up till 8. And if you have more than 8, 9 and 12 and 13, that means it's toxicity. So target range is 5 to 8. What do you monitor? Very important. Three lines, last one. What do you monitor? Deep tendon reflexes. And what happens if there is a toxicity? Absence of DTR. So everyone should know magnesium sulfate. You are giving during for the mother to prevent seizure, and normal range up till 8 is okay. 5 to 8 is target range. And what do you monitor? DTR, deep tendon reflexes. Any question? Absence of DTR or toxicity. Number 2, respiratory rate. Respiratory rate is lower than normal, toxicity. Urine output, third one. So make sure we all remember these three answers are important for exam. You're giving magnesium sulfate, to prevent, and what do you monitor when you're giving magnesium sulfate? Toxicity. What are the toxicity? Three signs and symptoms are, is DTR, respiratory rate less than, monitor output. Urine output is low. That means it's affecting the kidney. So those are very important that we all know three signs and symptoms. Let's take a break. 10 minutes. Let's take a break.